Well, it's day two. Bryan Nehman and audience, at least yesterday. Today, I guess, would be day three. But day two yesterday of the actualization of what we know as the Squeegee collaborative policy or prescription, whatever you want to call it, where the six designated areas where it's verboten, can't do it, not allowed, signs up with the little line, you know, you have the circular thing with the little line, red line going through.
Yeah.
You can't do this.
Not allowed here.
Not allowed here when it comes to...
Although it doesn't say what you're not allowed to
right.
do here.
Well,
did you see that? Because
yeah.
I think this is important. This is what the sign says. It says, warning, high traffic intersection, no entering roadway except to use crosswalk, violator subject to enforcement. In need of services, contact the mayor's office, and then it has a phone number.
But you know why it says that? That's the actual law. What they used on that sign is actual transportation law that allows them to say, because it doesn't matter what you're doing physically, whether you are using a stick with a sponge at the end that we colloquially call squeegee mm-hmm. to go to a car, or whether you're begging, or whether whatever you're doing, if you're doing it at these six areas where you're in traffic, impeding traffic, you will get a warning, then a second warning, then a ticket is what we're hearing, right, Bryan?
Yeah, that's
so
right.
With day
citation.
Two, citation. So, because it's a civil type of thing. So with this whole thing underway, everybody, what I want to talk with you about, 410-467-WBAL. You can give us a call or text us on the GreegeeSolutionsModeling.com text line, 410-467-9225. First off, we know that young people at Pratt, let's take one location, Pratt and President Street have ignored the prohibition.
Mm-hmm.
They've been out there these 2 days. Why? Because we have camera footage of them being out there. Multiple media entities mm-hmm. showing at a minimum four, sometimes up to six people at Pratt and President Street. And the mayor responded a little bit to that yesterday, saying it's a process, Bryan. It's a process. It's not like an immediate, even though we were told
right.
from November 10th to January 10th was a 2-month process to get to a point where it would stop. And he's, because I went off saying, why don't we stop at November the 10th? Why are we giving a 2-month grace period? Well, we gave it so that they could get to this point.
Right. Well, listen, I'm willing to, I understand it's going to be, it's not just all of a sudden going to go away.
Why
it's
not?
Gonna
they take had 2 months to get it together. Why didn't they gradually between November 10th and January 10th let them know the countdown, the clock is coming, that there's a clock countdown till January 10th?
You
why
mean,
did it begin January 10th?
I mean, you want them to point at the side and can't you read it? No shirt, no shoes,
right.
no dice.
But I'm
right?
just saying, why did January 10th was it the beginning? What did they do in those 2 months in between to prepare for this?
They just chilled. I mean, honestly, I think that is the answer. They're like, you know what? We got a break.
Right,
all right, here we
right,
go. We got a breather. Nobody's going to be on our backs
okay.
for a while. It's just, you know, hey, you know, it's all going to come down January 10th, and we're going to have to start to enforce it. They didn't prepare
then serious
for it.
Stuff forgets.
I mean, they probably had meetings about it. How are you right. going to handle it? What is the way? They probably talked to police officers about how to interact. They probably worked with the different groups that are out there on a regular basis. But I think they all knew that there were still going to be kids out there, and they were just hoping that it was, you know, going to be enough for them not to see it. They're still there.
They're still there.
Now the question is, how long will they be there? And they're going to say, just give us some more time.
What's the punishment if they don't go away? Here's the thing, and they don't obey law enforcement. Here's the couple of things I want to know out of all this. Now that we have the clock started and we're in this for real, the kids say,
yeah,
process,
right.
for real, we're for real right now.
Right.
And that is... is how many of the people still doing this are under the age of 18 that we can legitimately call kids? How many people are juveniles? That's the first thing. Because they should have, they have a deputy mayor, Faith Leach, and all these people, mm-hmm. right, supposed to be out there, like, you know, dealing with them, talking to them, right? So how many are under 18? How many are over 18, which would classify them as adults, and they should be treated differently, in my mind, as adults than juveniles? And then number three, which is really, to me, should be number one, how many of these young people are carrying weapons? How many of these young people that we're watching on the streets, going back and forth in traffic, are carrying weapons? And I'm asking that because we are continuing to see, as recently as a few weeks ago, a 19-year-old who was arrested for carrying a weapon and robbing a convenience store. What did he get, Bryan? What did he take from the store? Windex.
It was a Windex, yeah, right.
I was going to say so it was
a Kit Kat, but it was a Kit Kat.
He was a known offender at Light and Conway, the corner where, tragically, Timothy Reynolds was murdered by the, allegedly murdered by mm-hmm. the 15-year-old who's now standing, faced trial dates are coming up. But I guess what I'm saying is we should be able to approach this differently than, like, saying we're starting at square one January 10th.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you make a good point about, you know, the guns, because if you do wind up getting a citation, that means three times you did what you were told you shouldn't
you
be able to
the
do.
Law.
And right there with a cop, right? I'm assuming that is what's happening. The cop has seen this happen three times or had to give a warning twice, right? If that's the case, then I don't know what the law says, but to me, they should be able to frisk them.
I see a bulge on your body that is not normal, let me go that way, and I think that you have a weapon, I am allowed as law enforcement to run my, not go inside your club, run my hands across your pockets and everything to determine what's going on.
Okay, that's fine with me. Terry stops fine with me.
Yes.
And if you feel a gun, then boom, you're arrested and you're gone.
Boom.
Right?
But that would also tell us, Bryan, more importantly, what the motivations of these squeegee workers are. If they're carrying guns, that to me, we know that to be the case, this should change the whole dynamic. This should change everything about the way that this is approached.
Well, but the other thing is that you wonder about what's happening and how this is being enforced. So if you know you get three warnings, like, do you get three total warnings or do you get three warnings in a day?
Right. Do we start all over again?
Does it reset today for morning rush hour?
And then
tomorrow you get another new three. I'm serious about that.
I know exactly what you're saying.
How does it work for that?
Right,
and if you really do have to have these three warnings, that means you're going to have the same cop there to see it.
To distinguish who's who.
Because it's not getting put into a database
that. See, that's what I want to know. Are we keeping track? Look, there is a deputy mayor, Faith Leach, assigned to this. There are city officials assigned to this, working in city government. Are they keeping a memorialization? Are they keeping a record of contacts? Because police have to do that.
Well,
police officers have to keep a record of contacts with individuals.
Well, then I got to ask him for his name.
Exactly.
So, I mean, if he doesn't have to show ID, then how do I know that's his real name?
The way that I'm asking questions, everyone, and the interaction I had with Bryan is for a reason. We don't know enough about what they're doing to deal with something that is more than just a nuisance. It's not a nuisance when somebody gets shot and killed. It's not a nuisance when somebody's carrying a gun. It's well beyond that, Bryan.
Yeah. Before we get to the phone calls, by the way, 410-467-WBAL. You can also text greensolutionsremodeling.com. Text line, same number, 410-467-9225. The mayor was asked yesterday by Channel 11 about not just the kids being at the six intersections. They were saying, look, it's happening in other places. As well, they're moving to different locations. And he essentially said, we'll get to that.
We know that. And that's why our folks are going to go wherever they are. And that's why we said those areas itself is always evolving, right? That those are the ones that we're starting with. And that's going to be consistently evolving so that we can work on the issue.
All right. So it's going to be like roaming, like if Pratt and Light become the new hotspot or
question,
whatever.
But here's my question. If I was still sitting in a committee asking questions, what is the deterrent effect of what you're doing? If all you're telling me is that we expected this move, there's no deterrence. What are you actually achieving except moving it?
Exactly. It's whack-a-mole. That's what it is.
And that from any type of, because we're talking about a law being violated. We're not just talking about the fact that people don't like it at these corners. There's an actual transportation law that now the state's attorney, Ivan Bass, has quoted many times, Bryan, of what is being violated. So if you aren't trying to deter people from doing this, what are you doing? What are you doing?
Mm.
What's the whole thing? Let's get Dave in Baltimore. Dave, good morning. You're on WBAL with Bryan and me. What are your thoughts?
Yes, good morning, fellas. Hey, so I have a question. I work downtown every day for 30 years. I don't live downtown, but look, I know downtown. And I'm vigilant, very careful about my goings about. My question to your listening audience is, why are the good people of Baltimore not protesting every day at the doorsteps of this folksy, one-time activist mayor's office? That's what I don't get. It's on our lips, we're talking about it. It's on the media. It's a problem. But I don't see the outrage at the doorstep of the mayor.
And the reason is, Dave, because I know the individual interaction that you had. I don't think that there are, Bryan and Dave, enough people who have had that type of next-level interaction that they want to come and protest. I mean, most people don't like it, Dave, and they consider it an annoyance, but they haven't had their windshield wipers ripped off necessarily or, you know, the next level stuff.
Sure. Every person who's been murdered or shot probably has 100 people they know. What's 100 times 300 and some people?
I got
or
you.
Even 600?
I got
That's
you.
A lot of people. See you, buddy.
I got you. I appreciate it, Dave. But, you know, One of the things, Brian, with this whole thing of the, what the mayor's doing or isn't doing, there've been protests on overall violence, but not necessarily just individual squeegee stuff. There have been gatherings of people upset about the violence in the city.
Yeah, but no major protest or no major marches to say.
Except by family members of those who've been killed.
Yeah. Everybody's frustrated. Everybody's angry. Anytime you do the man on the street interviews, especially when there's a shooting in a certain neighborhood, you hear people who are mad. They're tired of this. They want more done. They want more cops. They want more consequences. But there hasn't been this, oh my God, we're not going to take this kind of moment anymore. That hasn't happened.
Because usually people who are affected by this are going about their lives every day. They're not harming anybody. They're just working or doing the right thing. Most people, most, not all, who put protests and things together are activists. And most of these people are not activists.
Exactly. And the activists don't want to protest the squeegeeing aspect.
No.
They believe the squeegeeers should be out there on the streets. They don't care about it.
Or I'm not going to say they should be out there. What I hear mostly from them is what they're doing is a necessity to survive.
Right.
And I'm saying that is not an option. There are a lot of people that can make an argument when they break the law that what they're doing is necessary to survive. That's not an option.
No.
You got to remove that option off the table. Okay, if you do this, you will be either arrested or you'll be punished in some way.
The only way for this thing to go away is you say that it's not acceptable.
Correct.
You are not allowed to be on the roads
Correct.
With a squeegee. We were not going to allow people to come into the middle of the street and touch other people's car. It is not going to be tolerated. And if you have these things that are set up with different intersections, it's just going to bleed into other places in the citation aspect of it. Maybe you wind up just, you know, by attrition or by, you know, just frustration from the squeegeers that they got to deal with the cops there. But then you got a cop at every single intersection as well. It's just there has to be a policy that we're not going to allow it. Instead, we've done this, like I say, this half pregnant idea where it's not allowed in certain areas, but we're not going to say anything about it in other areas until it becomes a problem in those areas. And then we're going to say then it's not OK.
Well, here's an example.
It doesn't make any sense on how it's going to work.
Here's an example I use, Brian. Back when we had Baltimore City Police Commissioner Anthony Betts was our commissioner. He, after the whole Michael Brown situation down in Ferguson, Missouri, he allowed 83 to be shut down and allowed those people, remember, to protest and block traffic and all the rest of that. When he left, Kevin Davis became police commissioner, and Kevin Davis said, we will not allow people to block traffic, that if you go out into traffic and stop traffic, you will be arrested. Guess what happened?
What?
They went out there, tried to stop traffic down on Pratt and Light Street, and three people got arrested, and all of a sudden people stopped blocking traffic.
Hmm.
Once the individuals who were promoting blocking traffic got arrested, other people said, I don't want to get arrested.
Right.
I don't want to go to jail or spend a night in jail. And until there is actually an arrest of somebody who is blocking traffic. I'm not talking about arresting people standing in the corner.
Yeah.
So don't conflate what I'm trying to say. When people are actually arrested for doing something that is illegal, that's when, Brian, I think you're going to see a majority, not all of it, a majority of it stop.
Yeah, right. Well, you have to have a cop there, too. I mean, look, you're going to have the police-borne body camera so you can see the talking to the person multiple times before they're arrested. But, yeah, you're going to have to arrest somebody. It looks like we have a texture that's got a little bit inside knowledge on the whole warning thing. It says the warnings will be documented in Axon, which is the document management system used by the Baltimore Police Department.
Okay.
And it says you can type the offender's name into Axon, which would populate any and all previous warnings
okay.
as well. So, but
okay.
you have to have the name.
Yes, you do. And it's be accurate. It's got to be accurate. They don't give you another name when
right.
you show up.
So, I mean, if it's a different officer or, you know, you're in a different location, can you just give out a fake name if you don't have to give an ID?
We're going to ask the mayor, and I would like it. And the mayor's been very helpful, but I just want you to know, Brandon, that whenever we've asked for someone from their office, whether it was Shantae Jackson from the mayor's Office of Neighborhood Safety Engagement or this new deputy mayor, and her title so long, I can't remember, Brian, Faith Leach, I think we should have the people doing this on to ask them, how are you keeping track of this? Like, do you remember in the Baltimore City Council hearing last year? They said there was 125 documented squeegee workers, and they were at, like, 30 corners or whatever. There was a way they documented that. So how are you keeping track of this?
Yeah. This is an interesting text, and I want to read it because I think a lot of people think this, and it's race-related. And as good morning, guys. If this were a mixed-race issue, meaning there were some white squeegeeers out there, the problem would be much easier to solve. You'd just basically be able to say you can't do it anymore. The facts are that people are very sensitive about screaming too loudly because the squeegee kids are black. My wife to this day defends the activity because she knows firsthand how terrible and how hard their home life is for many of these kids. I think there's a lot to that.
Absolutely.
I think that's absolutely true, and that is a component of this.
But what you have to tell anyone, Mike, in this situation is, I don't think there's people with blood flowing through their veins who don't feel some sympathy for somebody who would risk their life running through traffic in order to get a couple of bucks. But even though you feel sympathy for that, you can't do it. You can't do that. To try to survive. Like I said, I can bring up a lot of examples about people who do illegal things to survive, and we don't allow that.
Right.
Well, you feel sympathy, but you say you can't do that.
Yeah, but the sympathy stops when I say, don't wash my car, right, and then you bang on my car, or you break my windshield wiper, or you spit on my car. Then it becomes anger.
Anger, that's what we saw.
That's the deal that we have a problem with.
That's what we saw with Timothy Reynolds. Let's get Joanne in Baltimore. Joanne, good morning. You're on WBAO Brandon. What are your thoughts?
Good morning. I think this whole thing is a joke. And with the citation, if you're not getting their ID, you really don't know who they are. And if they don't pay the citation, then what happens?
Right.
Who follows up on the citation?
Right. We don't know. And that's one of the things in this whole process is there are too many unknowns, Joanne, about how you enforce this.
Do we even know that the citation, there is a monetary figure? Is there really a fine attached to the citation?
I haven't seen that reported yet, but I'm sure there would be.
Hasn't been reported anywhere. Have you seen a dollar figure on any of it? What is it? $15, $30, $40?
But Joanne, the point you bring up is very important, which is going through all this stuff we're doing, is any of this going to deter these young people? Like, what's the reason for them to stop doing it?
Right. There is no deterrent. So I love listening to you guys.
Thank you,
Joanne.
Be safe. Be safe driving. I appreciate it. Look, you know, I am not opposed to trying to get these young people, and have not been with this whole collaborative, into another type of, you know, situation, whether it's education or a job, you know, earn while you learn, whatever. What I'm saying, though, is they're still allowing them to do this while they do that. And you got to stop this. You stop this and then get them into these other things. You don't keep it going while you're doing these other things.
Yeah.
And that's what they're doing.
Yeah. It's hard for me to see how this is going to work, right? I mean, and then, you know, the answer is going to be, you got to give it time. You got to
let's focus on one corner. Let's look at, will Pratt and President still have people on day three? That's what I want to know. Will they still be there? And I'm not talking about the five. Right. I don't know what's happening to the other five. Will they still be there?
Your odds would be really, really bad on FanDuel.